I've been a chemist most of my life, and chemists are smelly. You know, we as a culture have pretty much rejected them. We don't want any chemicals in our food. We don't want any chemicals anywhere except in our oil, and we maybe would rather have that not be had chemicals in it. So chemists are, they've been pretty much downgraded in our society. So the beautiful minds are physicists and mathematicians, and you know, but not chemists. And I'm not going to talk about what I'm doing right now. I'm going to talk about something that I did. There was a lot of discussion between me and my wife as to what I would talk about, because if I talk about the invention of PCR, which is an interesting story, it's just too complicated to explain to an audience that you can't see, which I can't see you guys. And what isn't that complicated is my first experiences with a technical kind of a thing. The kind of thing that I was later going to learn was the way things worked when I finally went to Georgia Tech. And I said, well, that's engineering and stuff. But I already knew that as a 13-year-old. And I've often wondered about how the hell did I know how to, I mean, that if you wanted to find something out, the best way to do it was not to look it up in a book, but to do an experiment, and you could do it in your backyard kind of thing. So this whole process, I had never figured out how come I knew that at 13, but I did. And I wanted to design a rocket. Most 13-year-old boys back then, it was in the 50s, wanted to do that. They wanted it to make a certain noise when it took off, which was not a bang, like a boom, because the kind of stuff that they entrusted you with in the amateur rocketry guides and stuff was like zinc, sulfur, various fuels, but they exploded and the rocket would go up end over end, and it was kind of stupid looking compared to the Cape Canaveral rockets, which went like that, and it was like, we wanted that effect. And I thought, you don't get that and we wanted it actually to be comfortable for a little frog. And then, because we knew that frogs had aspirations for space travel, and they were always acting like it at any rate. And it needed the specification, it needed to fit inside of those little canisters that they sold you film in back then when people used film, these little silver cans that you screw the top down, and that needed to be able to be stuck in the top of the rocket. And it needed to have some kind of padding to make it not uncomfortable for the little frog, and also to keep it from being hot. So there was a whole lot of considerations in the design, but all of them are things that I did assiduously experiments to see if they work, you know. We did we had a book. See, it was from Fort Sill, Oklahoma. There was a missile base there, and they provided young amateur rocketeers with a little book, which was pretty much worthless because they were worried about telling you anything that might blow your head off. And like that included almost anything that was going to make a good rocket fuel had that potential. But it did, the way it told you what we really needed to know was this one paragraph near the end that one of my friends, Buzz Wilson, who helped, has just sent me that book recently, and it says, do not ever heat a mixture of sugar and potassium perchlorate. And I thought, and at the time when I read that, I said, why the hell would anybody want to do that? Why sugar? You know, and the druggist up the street, which is back in the 50s, late 50s, remember the Russians had put a satellite up, the Sputnik thing, and we were desperate to catch up. And little boys making rockets was actually considered patriotic. It was like, you weren't like some little kid that was going to blow the neighborhood up. You could set them off in your own yard. And this is, I mean, so, but the druggist in our neighborhood would, you know, I asked him, I said, do you have any potassium perchlorate? And he said, no. He said, we've got potassium nitrate. And I said, that would probably do it, you know. And so I knew a little chemistry at 13, but I knew that that was an oxidizing thing like potassium perchlorate. It wasn't quite as active. But I thought, and why would you heat a mixture of it? You know, what would that do? So I don't know why the spirit of Isaac Newton was hanging around my house, but I knew that if you want to find something out, you don't look it up in a book, you do it. You do an experiment. So the first thing I had to deal with is what proportion of potassium nitrate to sugar would make this thing not something you'd want to heat, you know? And so I made 10 little piles in my driveway of potassium nitrate and sugar at 10 different ratios and lit them on fire and watched them, because I knew what you want from a rocket fuel is you want something that burns rapidly and turns the solid of the fuel into gas. You don't want any residue, because that would mean it's not sufficient. I mean, an efficient rocket fuel would be 100% turned into a gaseous state, and it would happen quickly, and it would cause some heat. And so I looked at the little piles burning. I said, there. 50-50 by volume. That was lucky, because it meant when you're mixing the stuff up, it turns out that's 60-40 by weight, but by volume, which was easier for me to deal with, it was 50-50. And so I said, all right, what happens now when you heat it? And what are they talking about, what you're not supposed to do there? And I thought, oh, you know what you're supposed to do? Probably you would heat it because it would make a more intimate mixture out of those two things. You don't want to explode it right there before you put it in the rocket. But it would be nice if they were very, very well mixed. And if you heated it to the point where the sugar melted, which sugar will do, they call it caramelizing, it would mix the two ingredients thoroughly. And it turned out by just the good fortune of this particular mixture was that it would melt, and then it would set back up as a nice hardened solid that was it would burn like a bat. It was like, whereas the powder would just go, the little pieces of this, once the solid was fused again, it was like solid, just a little ball of it would dance around when you lit it on fire. And I thought, that is a rocket fuel. And that will get a frog into space. And so now, and the beauty of Columbia, South Carolina in the late 50s, in light of the Soviet advance in space, was that everybody that would these days try to put you in jail for messing with that kind of stuff was happy to help you out. Like the guy at the hardware store would sell us dynamite fuse, you know, 100 feet of dynamite fuse at a decent price. And the druggist, I said, we need this in larger quantities, the potassium nitrate. So he started buying pound jars of potassium nitrate. And we started doing some really interesting, at first we were just doing experiments where we'd mix it, you know, just do the chemistry part of it, see what was the best combination of, I mean, the best sort of conditions. And then we started to make the rockets. And the first ones we made were they were little, you know, things about this big, aluminum tubes. And we graduated after a while to big ones. They were about four feet tall, and they were an inch and a quarter in diameter. And they were made out, we decided that something heavier than aluminum would make a better rocket, because what we wanted is it to be stable. We did not want it to flip around and around as it went up. We wanted it to have inertia. And the fins that we welded, we didn't weld them, we spot welded them, is what we did onto the bottom, which we slowly, meticulously cut the damn things out of eighth inch steel. And that was a long, hard process. And we had to do it often because sometimes they crashed. But we made nice fins. I studied the physics as it was. In one of the books I had, it talked about the fact that the nozzle, you don't just punch a hole in the bottom of a rocket. If you want it to break the sound barrier, you have to make make a nozzle at the bottom, which has an inward, like a 60 degree inward going phase, then a section that's about the size of a pencil, fortunately, because you could make it out of, we were making this out of a plaster of Paris that had asbestos in it, and we could make the nozzle, and so it's supposed to come in at 60 degrees and go out at 30, and that's supposed to allow it somehow to break. It didn't explain to me why that would break the sound barrier, but I didn't even know what the sound barrier was exactly, except that the jets did it. I mean, the jets flying over our house, we could hear when they were going faster than the sound. And it sounded exciting, too, you know. So we made the nozzle. This was in the summer. We had lots of time to kill, you know. So we could work on this all day long. And my mother was a dear lady who somehow had the idea that the only danger that we were ever in from doing this stuff was to blow our eyes out. So she would be watching out of the upstairs window, like, "Now, don't you boys blow your eyes out, you know?" But I figured, well, as long as we don't blow our eyes out, it's okay if we burn down a tree, which in one time when we were, like when you were making this fuel, you'd have to melt the potassium nitrate and sugar together in a little pot over a charcoal stove. We did it outside, which is a good idea, because we could have done it in the house and we'd have had a real problem. But we discovered that while you were heating the fuel at the beginning, once you'd mixed it together before you put it in the rocket, when you were heating it, you had to stir it quite well. In fact, we had to make a little wooden spoon with a very flat front. I mean, you had to saw off basically a normal wooden spoon so that when you scrape the bottom of the pot, it would not leave any little pieces of the fuel, because we discovered quickly that while it's melting, you have to do it slowly. If it ever gets red looking, or these little red places forming in it, get the hell out of there. And it's like, because it will go up by itself. And so that there was little things like that. We were observing what we were doing and taking notes. And it's like, see, once you had the rocket built, then you'd pour the fuel in it. And the first couple of times we did it, we just poured it in and let it set up. We'd put the fuse in first before at the bottom, so it was attached. It would get stuck to the fuel. And they made a lot of smoke, and they did burn. And sometimes they would lift off a little, but not really what we wanted. And what I started thinking, and you know, I can't figure out where all these things came from in my head, because, I mean, I knew about geometry. I didn't know differential calculus at all. I didn't think of what is the rate at which this is burning, but I realized somehow intuitively that if while the fuel was getting fused, when it was still a liquid, it was down in the tube that you'd pour it in, if you pushed a dowel, like a little wooden dowel, about say three-eighths of an inch wide, down the thing and turned it while the fuel was setting up, you'd end up with a hole going all the way through the rocket from the bottom to the top. And you could put a piece of balsa wood, like a little circle of balsa wood on top of that, at the very top of it, and pour another 5 or 6 inches of fuel on that to plug the top. So now you have, when you light this thing, the fuse, the fire goes from inside to the outside rather than up the tube, which vastly increases the rate of combustion. Because, I mean, later on I realized, okay, the differentials of, it's the radius growing larger, and it makes the perfect thing. You don't have to have a pump that pumps fuel in like a, you get the same effect in that it goes whoosh, because as it's going up, as it's burning a bigger and bigger area as it goes up, as it does its little burning thing. And it was a very spectacular kind of a thing. And the first person, the official person to watch it, but was a cop. And because at first when we started, we were doing it in our backyard, and we had neighbors. And apparently one of them notified the local constable that there was somebody setting off rockets that could fall on their house, which we had taken that into account. We knew that we didn't want to fire it toward anything, but we were sitting out in the backyard about to light the fuse, and this cop just sort of wandered up and he was looking at it. And this is the nature of it's like these days, that would get you arrested quickly. We'd have been handcuffs, dragged, you know. No, it wasn't that way then. It was patriotic what we were doing. We were trying to catch up with the Russians. And so the cop just sort of, he looked at it, and the guy, Jimmy Papadio was his name, one of my friends who was lighting the fuse, wasn't facing toward where the cop was coming from. We were sitting back away watching, and we saw him, and we said, Jimmy, no, don't, you know. And he didn't understand why, and he went ahead and lit the fuse. And the cop just sort of watched it, and this time it went, it was a nice, fairly good, it was still, that was when we were still using the aluminum, and it wasn't quite as impressive as later. But the cop was impressed, and it went up way over the houses and everything. And so he kind of encouraged us to say, you know, doesn't one of you have a driver's license, and you can drive this thing out of town? Because, you know, he explained to us that there was an abandoned sand pit about 10 miles outside of Columbia that he thought it would make a good rocket range. And so that was a very helpful cop. And so we did. And so as the rockets got bigger, and then the frogs got involved, we made the little chamber for the frogs and shielded it with all kind of stuff so that the frog would, at the very end, see, if you have the hole up through there, it builds up its pressure inside the tube, and then it starts burning through the plug, which is the fuel that's been poured into the very top of the rocket. And as soon as it gets through there, then it blows the pressure, whatever left pressure is left in the tube. It now blows out the nose cone. That would like blow out between the nose cone and the frog, there was like a bunch of padding. You put like ground up balsa wood in there. And then right on the top of the frog's little chamber to protect him from the heat, there'd be a bunch of this little asbestos kind of stuff ground up in there. And then it would have a little red parachute to bring him back, because the rocket would fall wherever it fell. And it usually would bury itself in the sand pit. By the time we got down to the sand pit, the rocket would fall and go all the way into the sand and just leave the fins kind of sticking out. And if we were lucky, they didn't get bent, because we could use it again. So that actually put a frog up. What I calculated, I said, how do we know how far this is going? And so we could measure how far it was from where we were standing with our little hard hats on, by the way. And we did not worry about blowing our eyes out by then, because my mother was back home, not in the window watching us. And so we thought that would be silly to wear safety glasses or something like that. And because we were going to be some little distance from this because we had the luxury of dynamite fuse. We estimated the height of the thing by saying when you can see the red parachute, because the thing actually goes out of sight, and you see the red parachute, we'll know how high that is if we have this little protractor attached to a pointer on a little tripod which you had made. So you pointed at me and say, okay, there's where I saw the thing the first time. Assuming that it's right above where it took off, this is how you can do it with trigonometry. You can determine how high the thing went. And I thought, I said, when I see it, it's 2 miles high. And Buzz, one of my friends, Buzz, his dad was a pilot. He had a little Cessna. And he said, you know, that thing, you don't send something 2 miles up there. And I said, yeah, I think that's when I see it. I don't know how high it goes, but when I first see it, I've measured it a couple of times now. It's about 2 miles high. So he flew over our sandpit one day, a little too low for safety, because he didn't realize this thing was going to go past him at a rapid clip. And we don't know if it went 2.5 or 3 miles, but it passed him at 2. And it was, and the frog, miraculously, we had, the frog survived. I mean, the very first time the frog didn't survive, but the whole rocket blew up. It was right now, it was like, the thing, we would launch it we had a big piece of, they call that stuff that makes, when you're pouring concrete, you a lot of times stick these little rods in it, and they have a name. Yeah, rebar. We had that. It was about 20 feet long, and it was stuck in the sand, and it had the direction that the rocket was supposed to, because, you know, when it first takes off, the fins won't do it any good. So this would give it about 20 feet to get moving to the point where the fins could keep the back of the rocket down. And it was like, it was a really cute little system. It was really, and here's these little boys doing it. You know, I look back at it and I said, Jesus Christ, you know. We were doing this when I was about 14. We were really getting it to work. And who knows how high that frog went. We don't know how the Russians are doing, actually. But they can't be doing much better. It's like, their satellite didn't have a frog in it. It's but it was quite a way to sort of be. It's a fun way to spend the summer, and it was like it sort of reinforced these feelings that I already had about how you do science. I mean that you experiment, that you try everything that might fail or whatever. You do as many little experiments on the ground before you ever put the frog in there. But we really enjoyed it. And once we moved out of the neighborhood, out to the sand pit, then there were some people that lived near the sand pit that got a little irritated because it landed in the pine trees and it started a little fire. But most people, I don't think they cared. It turned out we were in the flight pattern from Columbia Airport, which was not, there weren't enough planes taken off to realize that until this one time. I think that's enough.